together, and we've asked all the neighbors to submit to us their questions, what their concerns are, issues they want to talk about, and hear the views of the candidates, and we distill those, and we're going to present those to the candidates tonight. Of course, everybody knows that we don't endorse a position on any issue, and we don't endorse any particular candidates. But we do think this is an important time, and we enjoy bringing this to you. So here's what our format will be tonight. We're going to give each one of the candidates. Oh, by the way, I do want to point out, for those of you who come to these over the years, it's a sure sign of recovery of our economy that we now have wireless microphones. Thank you, Mr. Obama. We do have. The format that we'll be following tonight, first we're going to give everybody 2 minutes to introduce themselves and say whatever they want to for 2 minutes. Then after that, I've got a series of questions. Each one of the candidates will field one first, and then we'll go to the next one so everybody gets one first. Now I have 7 questions here, so maybe you guys, maybe that's what the cookies will be about. Is this cutting in and out?
Yeah. No.
Well, then why don't I just talk? Yeah. Can you guys hear me okay?
Yeah. Oh, sure.
Probably better. After each one of these, you'll get 1 minute to respond to these. Now, folks, when you get 30 seconds away from when your time is up, my friend Mike Bepke here, you see he's a large guy. He looks nice, but don't go over your time. You have 30 seconds to finish. He'll wave the yield sign. When your time is completely up, he'll go red on you. After that is whack-a-mole. Now, if you're very good, we do have 2 of these extra cookie buckets. I think I'm not going to work that, all right? So please honor the time. And I will say, it always, I think, behooves you as a candidate to be concise as you can possibly be. Nobody knows. They don't know what these questions are we're going to ask, so they'll be hearing them for the first time. There are none of these issues that are going to surprise you. There are things you've already thought about, of course. Nonetheless, you'll have 1 minute to respond to each of my 7 questions. If you don't use all that time, that's wonderful. So you're much better off just to say what you have to say and then move on. Otherwise, we put the mic on you. Okay, at the end of the 7th period, the 7 questions as we rotate through those, we have a series of just yes or no's, and you've got a little envelope in front of you. At the end, we're going to go through several different issues, and you're going to say yes or no, thumbs up or thumbs down. You're just going to hold it up and let us know. So, so once that's done, then they'll have another. Is it 1 minute, Deb, or 2 minutes at the end? 1 minute at the end, then to kind of summarize. Then we'll dismiss everybody. Deb thinks you should know that my name is John Davis. I think that's probably a liability issue. you know how many John Davises there are. So given that, then what we'd like to do is just start by an introduction. You get 2 minutes apiece. I hope that microphone works better than this one did. If it cuts out, maybe we'll just hold both of them up there and hope that one of them works. Yeah. So, Rochelle, if you'd like to go first, just give us 2 minutes and tell us, and then just hand it right on down the road.
Hi, good evening. Oh, see? It's not working, is it?
Yeah,
it is. Now, that's very strange. I can't tell at all that it's working, so very strange. So, good evening, everyone. My name's Rochelle Maroyan. I'm obviously running for Santa Cruz City Council, or else it would be really weird if I was sitting up here doing this. I grew up in Santa Cruz. It's my hometown, and I'm running because I love living here. I went away to college, worked in LA, worked in San Francisco. Heartstrings pulled me back here, though. I just kept comparing everything to my experience in San... Oh, there we go. To my experience in Santa Cruz, and it brought me back here, and I knew that I wanted to stay here for good and make a life for myself, and so I did. And from the time I got back, I've been really active in the community, whether it's been helping people run for office themselves, registering voters. I knew at a pretty early age that who we elect to office makes a huge difference in how our communities run. And there we go again. And how our schools are, and whether or not we have the type of resources we want for the community. So I've just always believed in community activism and being involved in the community. I've been on the Public Works and Transportation Commission for the past 7 years. I was chair at one point. I went to bat for neighborhood issues several times when I didn't think neighborhoods were getting heard and their issues getting heard. I've also been very active in the local Democratic Party, where I've been chair of the Democratic Central Committee, which is, I know it's a strange name, it's actually the Democratic Party of Santa Cruz County. I've also worked in the private sector, so I also have that experience working in high-tech companies. I've also worked for the California State Assembly, where I worked in public policy for 5 years for a California Assembly member. I think the next person who holds a position on City Council needs to have a variety of experience. I bring a lot more private sector experience than many of my opponents do, or I should say co-candidates, to be more collegial. So I hope you consider voting for me on Election Day. Thank you very much.
Can you all hear me in the back if I just speak like this? Because this microphone is going in and out. Is that going to work for everybody?
Okay, can you all hear me? Is this good? All right, thank you so much for coming out. My name is Lainey Sherman. It's really exciting to see so many engaged people from our neighborhoods here in Santa Cruz. Of course, our neighborhoods are the foundation of our quality of life. Many of you recognize me because I've come and spoken at your block parties. Ever since the beginning of those block parties, I've been coming and doing short 15 to 20 minute presentations about how to keep yourself safe in your neighborhoods, in your homes, how the cohesiveness of your neighborhoods contributes to your safety and security. When I'm not at your neighborhood block parties or speaking in front of you at a candidate forum, I'm teaching in our middle schools and our high schools and also through the Department of Parks and Recreation here in Santa Cruz and in Capitola and at UCSC. Mostly I work with young people. I designed a safety skills program about 7 years ago, and since then I've reached over 9,000 young people. My job is literally keeping young people in this town safe. I teach them about how to carry themselves. I teach them about how to protect themselves. It's a widely supported program because it contributes to student safety, both in the schools where we've identified bullies, we've reduced bullying, we've seen infrastructure improvements, and also at home. Turns out that students often teach their parents some of the things that I've taught them. This work that I've done has literally brought pedophiles off the streets and into our prisons and contributed really well to the safety of our community. One of the things that I learned from pushing that program forward was how to work with a wide range of people towards a common vision. I've worked with police departments, school boards, city councils, principals, administrators, people that often don't see eye to eye on many important issues, but we all agree that our kids need to be safer. That experience collaborating with a broad range of people will serve me very well as a city council member. Teaching self-defense for the past 15 years all over the world and for the past decade here in Santa Cruz has brought me a unique perspective on public safety, and I hope you'll give me the opportunity to take that to the next level and bring it to governance and policy making here in our city. I would be honored to have your support. Thank you.
I want to thank everyone for being here tonight. I think this, we talked beforehand, this is the 8th or 9th forum, and I think one of the things I like about the Santa Cruz Neighbors Forum the most is because just talking with each of you beforehand, we had a broad cross-section of issues from water to housing to social services, and I think the questions and our responses are representative of all of the issues that are really important to our town. That said, 4 years ago, I was elected to the City Council, and I ran on a platform to focus on public safety, economic development, and engaging our community in our policy making. And over the past 4 years, I've focused on those very issues. As the chair of the Public Safety Committee, I've looked at how we provide innovative public safety programs, to look at how we provide improved rehabilitation for drug and alcohol, as well as mental health services to deal with what has become a chronic arrest rate of the same people downtown. Our deputy chief of police has told us directly, we can't arrest our way out of this problem. I think we're looking at ways to address this problem in a way that's more effective. The other program I've been working on is working with our local schools, and that is Santa Cruz City Schools has approached the council as far as collaborating with them on developing improved safety programs. We've worked with them to establish safe school zones at each of the schools in the district, as well as improve security measures to make sure kids are safe. As chair of the library board, I've worked with local jurisdictions to make sure we have access for internet for kids and also improve literacy after school programs in our facilities. And last, in terms of economic development, I'm focused on ways where we can make improved outreach to make starting a business here in Santa Cruz as easy as possible. We want to make sure that we have fees that are reflective of opportunities for people to invest and start businesses here. I'm really proud also of my work to establish the first neighborhood grant program where we look at bringing neighbors in to invest in our community. I want to thank you and I look forward to talking further about issues here in Santa Cruz.
Hi everybody, I'm Cynthia Chase and it seems a little unfair to put cookies in front of us and not let us eat them yet. But I am food motivated, so hopefully by the end I'll get another passion cookie. I'm really happy to be here tonight. I came here about 15 years ago as a student at UCSC. I transferred in here from the University of Alaska, and I fell in love here. I love our community. I became very involved in our community. I was an intern with the probation department and also here in our local jails. And that really got my foot in the door and allowed me, unlike a lot of people that I went to school with, to actually stay here and get a job that supported me and helped me afford an affordable housing unit later on in my life. And that's a huge part of my story. I've then worked as a probation officer collaborating with all the county departments and local law enforcement treatment programs and rehabilitation to really help improve public safety in our community. And then from there, I went on to get my graduate degree in social work, where I teach at both the School of Social Work at San Jose State and CSUMB and help educate incoming students about policy, legislation, program implementation, also program evaluation. We need to be smart about where our money is going, where we're spending it, and the effectiveness of programs. And then I got the job that I have now, which is the director of the GEMA program, which is, again, a public safety-oriented program that's actually reduced crime right here in our community by using evidence-based programs that help improve public safety and also improve lives. And really what I want to focus on is that none of that would be possible without communication and collaboration with many of you in the community who helped to found GEMA, and also county departments and city who really have an opportunity to work together better to come up with solutions for our city. And as a Parks and Rec Commission member, I'm also really committed to making sure that we're making our parks safe for all people in our community. I really would appreciate your vote.
Good evening, I'm Bruce Van Allen. I'm also a candidate for City Council, and thank you very much for coming tonight. This is an honor to be in front of the members of Santa Cruz Neighbors and a continuation of the honor of appearing at all these forums. I'm running because I've been deeply involved in Santa Cruz community affairs for about 45 years. One of my major areas of interest has been to make the river back into a centerpiece of Santa Cruz instead of a back alley that it is now. And that means in several different ways. We want to restore the habitat because it's a crucial link between the bay and the mountains. But also, it needs to be a place where everybody feels welcome and safe. And this is my highest priority right now, is that to get the river back, it's got to be a socially positive space. And it ought to be the centerpiece of town. And I've been working, I helped write most of the plans for the river that are slowly making their way forward. We finally got the new little bridge up by Highway 1, which helps a little bit. But there's a lot more to do. And one of the things that I've found in working on the river is that the way things actually get done and accomplished on a practical level is when people see beyond divisions and find common ground and move forward. And this has taught me that the real art of politics is to be able to work with people that you don't agree with about everything, but to find common ground. And so that's the way I do my practice. Now, more recently, I've been working very hard to make sure that Santa Cruz has a secure water supply. I was in the group that helped steer the city away from the desal proposal, but at the same time, I got right in there when the Mayor Bryant at the time and the city manager said we needed to pause, and I said, we can't let this just be a deadlock. Let's find a constructive way to move forward, and that led to the process that's underway right now. I've been in private business as a woodworker and a software developer. I help people participate in elections, and to me, this is the kind of community that always gives back. So I want a safe, beautiful, habitat-full river, and I want a community that in which everyone feels that they have a part and a voice. Thank you very much.
Folks, before before we really get into the middle of this, we do have two empty seats down here. I'd encourage someone to come down and take them. We have three. Do I hear four? Please fill them up, folks. It's going to be a little while. Also, very kind of everybody to clap, but that's over for the time being. Now, let's answer your questions, because we really want to jam through this as much as we possibly can. Now, among all the questions that we've got, one that is conspicuously absent is about water. We've got a few of these flyers in the back that we'd like for you to grab and take a look at. There's a lot of attention going on right now about water, as there should be. There is a forum about a month away, so if you'll pay attention to this, it will give you an opportunity to go in and really learn a lot about what people are thinking and share your own thoughts. So we're not going to talk about water today. That's one conspicuously absent question here. But I wanted to make you all aware of that. So now we'll go ahead and begin with the questions. Bruce, if you have the microphone still, then we'll go ahead and let you do the first one, and it's going to be an easy one, folks. You have 1 minute to answer these. In 30 seconds, Mike's going to start looking at you. Okay, so you have a minute. The first question is, of course, this is a grassroots group, and we're all representing our neighborhoods and concerned about local issues. We'd like for you just to name one neighborhood or community-based project that you've worked on. So just think of one. You have 1 minute to talk.
Mark Premack will remember this one. I used to live on Pine Place, out in those beautiful Art Deco apartments that are above City Hall. And a bunch of us neighbors said that this walkway that comes down the hill there towards City Hall, towards Chestnut Street, was kind of trashed and it was dangerous. And we persuaded the city, and Mark really led that, but I was chimed in on it and felt proud of our having done that. It's now a beautiful way to walk, get from the lower part of the city up to the upper part. And felt good about having contributed to that.
So when I actually moved into the complex that was an affordable housing unit about 10 years ago, I was on the board, the Homeowners Association, and what was very quickly found out was that the renovations that had been done were actually unsafe, and many of the stairwells could not be used, families could not get in and out of their homes, and so I actually was vice president and president of the Homeowners Association when we actually sued the builder and actually won our lawsuit to make sure that the housing there was safe for families and children to continue to live in the complex that they worked so hard to afford and be able to live in. And so I'm really proud that that was something that I was able to be a part of and help a lot of people accomplish.
About 7 years ago, there was a murder that took place in the Beach Flats area. I read in the paper that the person living next door said, I knew that something was not right, I just didn't know who to call. So those door hangers that you have hanging around there are something I created as a way to make sure that the public knew how to get in touch with the appropriate agency to deal with safety issues. Community printers donated all the printing costs and we created in partnership with San Luis neighbors. I'm still proud that they're still in use today. I also, just as an aside, working in the community is really important to me. It's one of the things I value most. I worked with the family of Sergeant Charles Derby, the first youth police officer in the city to rededicate a park, and worked with his family to create a memorial at Sergeant Charles Derby Park. And so I think it's important to always work with our neighbors to make sure that our town reflects the values of each of our families.
About 7 or 8 years ago, I was invited to teach a safety class at a senior center, and I expected to teach sort of my standard class that I often teach, but the first thing I do when I sit down with anyone that I'm working with is I ask them why they wanted to take the class in the first place, and it turned out from working with these older people that lighting was a major problem at their senior center. There wasn't adequate lighting, and people didn't feel safe. So although I expected to teach my normal class, I ended doing a community outreach program and improving the lighting situation at that center so those seniors feel much safer in their homes and in their neighborhood now.
So in my role as chair of the Public Works and Transportation Commission, I had a neighborhood approach me with two issues. 6 years ago, they asked for parking permits for their street because their street basically became an open air meth and heroin dealing street, and they wanted a crosswalk, and they put that request in 3 years ago. They had not received really notice or a hearing from the city on either issue. They asked me to come over to their neighborhood, and I did. I met with them. I saw that you were taking your life in your own hands just across the street in front of their complex. And really, without consulting with staff, I just went ahead and put those items on our agenda so they could get heard and they could go through the public process that for some reason hadn't been happening. And so I'm really proud to say today, even though people weren't necessarily happy with me at City Hall, that street has the parking permits now and they have a crosswalk.
Thank you, Michelle, very good. Thank you, all good answers. An impressive group of people. If you want to just hold on to Mike, you can take the next one. Now that you've had just a moment to blow your own horn and incredible work all of you are doing, we're going to ask you to be a little bit critical and prep and positive as well. The next question is, considering the City Council's actions over the last 4 years, David, you don't need to be nervous about this. one thing they did that you liked, and one thing they did you didn't like.
Do you want me to take that first?
You only have a minute, sure.
Okay, so I was not pleased with the city's recent decision to give $6 million to three large hotel developers. I thought that was a questionable decision. I'm not sure that has community benefit that can be shared equitably in our community, and I want to make sure that when we distribute funds from our general fund, that is shared by as many people as possible in our community. I was really proud of the city for setting a reset on the decision about desal and how we're going to move forward with our water. I know we said we weren't going to talk about water tonight, but after investing so much money in a desal plant, I thought it reflected really well on our city's ability to listen to citizens, that they were willing to put a reset on that and appoint a citizen supply water advisory committee. I was very pleased with that decision.
I'm really proud that the city council and the city manager has made cleaning up Cal's Beach a priority. It's a budget priority this year, and it's also something that we've taken great pains to really focus on cleaning up our beaches and making them safe for people. I think that's something for me that I will continue. In fact, at the September 23rd council meeting, I've been working with Save the Waves, the Coastal Watershed Council, and Surfrider to form a coalition to even explore even more deeper ways that we can address that very issue. One issue that I think I would disagree with, but I will say that we should have done a better job, and that is the hotel rehabilitation program. I think it's one that's not understood as well as it could be. It isn't about giving away corporate money. It's about, one, providing incentives in the wake of the elimination of the redevelopment agency. This is about providing incentives for the improvement of hotel properties. I think we could have done a better job in terms of not focusing the discussion on a particular property, because I think broad-based policy means we create a framework to make sure that there can be a solution to deal with this, and that would be the one I think we could have done a better job on.
Thank you, Dave.
I'm really happy that the Public Safety Task Force was put together by the council, and I'm specifically really happy with the recommendations that came out of that were very broad-based, that included intervention for young people, as well as prevention programs for young people and intervention for people moving throughout the system, and that out of that came the Downtown Accountability Program, which I think is really smart and effective. What I'm hearing most from folks when I go around in neighborhoods is that when they speak of things that concern them, they're really worried about their neighbors being evicted from their ADUs. And that's not the thing that I think the council certainly intended. There's unintended consequences that are happening here. And when people are talking about it to me, they're not saying that they're concerned about party houses. They're saying that they're concerned about people that are good neighbors and neighbors that they really want to try to keep are going to lose their homes, and that they're also going to lose the opportunity to have housing stock. And I would really like us to take another look at that and be really thoughtful about how to move forward.
I was very pleased when the city council had the very good sense to put a pause on the desal proposal. And this is very significant. I'm not the only one that's mentioned it, but we were headed in the direction that was going to cause very costly water and huge energy consumption for a desal plant. And the amount of investment in that project and that proposal was tremendous, and yet the city council did the right thing. And now we're headed in a much better direction. And I salute the former mayor, Ryan, and the whole city council for having the courage to do that. I was disappointed a few months ago when the council did not take action to make public financing of local campaigns the city's policy. This is something that's in 60 different cities around the country. It can be done. We had a very workable proposal before them, and instead they did a kind of a minimal measure. And the preventing the possibility of the domination of large large contributors to our local politics. It's an important public policy question for our community. We don't want the same thing happen that happened federally. Thank you.
So I really do like the fact that the city just recently decided to fund the Downtown Accountability Program to even go further than where it's gone. And we're already seeing positive results of it in terms of not having to rearrest the same folks over and over again, which hopefully will be shown in our nuisance crime numbers downtown. So really happy to see them doing that. I'm not really happy that the change in traffic pattern didn't happen downtown. I talked to so many people from out of town who have no idea, like they come into downtown where the town clock is and then there's that weird right turn you're supposed to take and they feel like they're getting lost. So I'd like to see our council take a proactive stand in making that a lot less confusing. And I'd like to see more signs so people can get around town and know that Ocean Street's not our downtown.
Thank you. Michelle, why don't you hang on and go first on the next one? Oh, I love you confused. I just want to be sure I do not. Third question, ladies and gentlemen. The Santa Cruz is perennial and perhaps most divisive issue is our homeless. Can you discuss any perspectives, solutions, or strategies that you support or introduce during your term? Perspectives, solutions, or strategies?
I think we need to know more about our homeless because we don't really even have a data point to know how many of them are here, maybe perhaps from out of town, and how many of them grew up here or have lived here for a long time. We have one survey that's taken every other year, and the only purpose of it is to count homeless people. We don't even know the questions that are asked, and that conclusion came to that two-thirds of those folks that were counting somehow have a connection to Santa Cruz. I'd like to see a much more extensive study done because I want prevention. If we just, do nothing to stem the tide of people that either are becoming homeless while they're residents here or people deciding to come here, this is going to be a continuous problem and we'll never see our way out of it. So I think we need more data because the data, that one survey is so different from the experience that police officers, social workers, and firefighters are having when they are working with folks in the homeless community.
So as I've been walking door to door, which is all I do lately, it seems, this is the largest issue that comes before me. When I ask people what their biggest concerns are about Santa Cruz, I hear people are concerned about our homeless population. And this is a huge issue that if we take as a monolithic whole, it's very overwhelming because it's so entrenched, so it's difficult to grapple with. But I think if we start breaking it down into the elements of that, those people that are experiencing homelessness, then we can start to grapple with it in a more effective way. So I personally, on the streets of Santa Cruz, see a lot of people that are struggling with mental health issues that are experiencing homelessness. I see a lot of people that are struggling with drug issues that are experiencing homelessness. I believe that if we provide services that wrap those people in social safety net, essentially, our city will actually save money. Cities like San Antonio, Texas, and Vancouver, British Columbia have saved an enormous amount of money by instituting recuperative care centers for mentally ill people, for example. That will free up our police to pursue actual criminals, which I think is all of our goals. Thanks.
I think the best solution is a regional solution. And I think that when we look at what we've done in terms of the public safety initiatives to better coordinate our services with the counties, I think that's our first step. I think we need to really look at how we can intelligently and thoughtfully work with the trained professionals in social services, mental health, to really provide some lasting solutions. We've seen, as chair of the Public Safety Committee, that many of the public safety issues deal with some of our chronic offenders that have mental illnesses and substance abuse. And I think how we kind of address those problems helps to provide a framework and a foundation to get them out of homelessness.
So the homelessness issue actually does really need to be divided into segments for lots of different reasons. One is to be able to tackle it effectively, but the other is to really look at where we have resources. The slices within the homeless population vary, and the resources available to support them vary. We need to be really smart about all the different services, programs, county, city, government agencies that are actually out there providing services to the general homeless population or the specific populations within it, so that we can be really smart about our resources and that we can collaborate and use them more effectively and target the areas that we can spend our money wisely and also not be creating a lot of redundant activity. We have so many people in this community that are committed to homelessness, from law enforcement and first responders to treatment, rehabilitation, and housing. We need to be communicating and working together so that we're making sure that we're being the most effective.
It's not my fault, but when I was mayor 32 years ago was when Santa Cruz actually experienced the onslaught of mass homelessness. And so I remember when we didn't have that. And it's a problem that was created partly at the federal level with massive cutbacks in housing subsidies by then President Reagan. And it's also something that is a state phenomenon because we're an attractive state, and it's a coastal phenomenon because we're an area with climate and a lot of things going on that draw people here at all income levels. And it's a local problem in that we have been so divided over it that we have lost the opportunity to be constructive. I'm an ally of the Smart Solutions to Homelessness, the new movement, which says let's treat people with respect, let's find what individual people with different conditions, whether it's addiction or mental illness or learned antisocial behavior, that get the help, whether it's they need to be accountable and pay for their crimes, but they also need the kind of help that allows them to dig their way out of the situation that they're in.
Thank you, Bruce. If you wouldn't mind handing it over to the mic to Dave. Dave, I'll let you go first this time.
Okay.
And here's a softball for you. In the past 21 months, more than 6,275 needles have been found on the streets, parks, and beaches of Santa Cruz. Can you help us understand the way you think about solving this problem, or is there even a deeper problem than the needles themselves?
I think that thank you for the question, because as chair of the Public Safety Committee, we had at least 150 people come to our council meetings to address this issue. We took action by, one, working directly with our county professionals in terms of having our city staff work with them to identify opportunities to address the issue of discarded needles. They continued to meet. The meetings resulted in reform of the needle exchange program, where they have actually county staff that's now operating it rather than volunteers that may not have been administrating the program in a way that met our city needs or even county health expectations. We also are looking at further ways where we can work to provide better opportunities to not only provide health care for these people that need it, but also looking at ongoing reform through better public meetings at the county level, which weren't taking place earlier. I think it's something, when we look at the areas, there's still a problem and we continue to work with them. My thought is, I think that we need to identify ways where we have this issue, we look at opportunities to have the administrators of the program kind of meet more directly with the city so that they can meet our city expectations.
Thank you, Dave, but I can see my man here is getting a little itchy.
Okay, so that's fine.
So I know that this issue actually was really brought forward because of concern from the community. And so I want to make sure that stays in the forefront of how we move forward on this, is that it does require collaboration and conversation between law enforcement, first responders, park rangers that are out there now, and continuing to talk to neighbors about what is happening in their individual neighborhoods, because there is such a wide variety of how this issue impacts each individual neighborhood. And then, of course, health services, where, you know, it's great that they're taking over the responsibility of the needles and collection and distribution, but we need to keep that dialogue going, and we need to also be measuring the impacts that we've had so far and see where else we can do some more work.
When I take kids down to the river for looking at the wildlife or taking water quality measurements, the last thing that I want or that their parents want is to encounter a needle and the dangers that come with that. And this is something that's very serious. What I have learned is that with the evidence shows from all over the place that the best thing is to have a good, competently run, professionally run needle exchange program. That without that, the problem will get far worse. And having a good professional needle exchange program allows the people involved in it to make sure that the people that they're meeting about needles get access to services, addiction treatment, and so on, rather than feeling isolated and therefore not dealing with their own problems. So I do think we need a strong needle exchange program, but I also think that this is a matter of the whole community recognizing all of our responsibility and our need to speak out when we see something that troubles us, as well as when we see someone in need of help. So it's a cooperative effort by all of us to really address this.
Thank you, Bruce. Just hand it back down this way.
I think it's indicative of a larger problem. I mean, Santa Cruz does have a high rate of drug use, and you know, it's really interesting. Our needle program here hands out twice as many needles as Santa Clara County's needle program, yet we're around one-fifth of their population. So that shows that there's something off. Either we have just a huge amount of people using meth and heroin or using needles for their drugs, or we're giving out way more than we should. And so that's something that I think we need to figure out. One thing is we don't have a strict one-to-one policy. We have a lot of exceptions for it, and I think that gets reflected in the amount of needles that we see in the Emmeline neighborhood. So I think we can have a needle program and maybe have some different best practices around handing needles out and be able to do both and protect the public health as well.
So improperly discarded needles are a huge safety problem that all of us need to grapple with. And I know that the needle exchange is a divisive issue, but I don't know of any effective alternative. Miami, Florida, for example, doesn't have any needle exchange program, and they have a much worse problem with improper disposal of needles than we have here. San Francisco has a more robust program than we have, and they have fewer improperly discarded needles. I'm really glad the county has taken over this program. I feel like it's brought a level of professionalism to the way it's administered. And I'd like to see us start a conversation about, for example, mobile units like San Francisco has. I think that that reduces the impact on specific neighborhoods, and it also allows us to reduce the number that we find on the streets because there's a mobile unit going around to pick those up. So I'd like that conversation, for example, to be started.
Thank you. Down to Cindy. We'll let you go first on this. It's kind of a new problem, actually, that we've seen, at least from the neighbors. This is the first time I recall seeing it, but there seems to have been an increasing problem with RVs parking in our neighborhoods and flushing their waste down the streets or down the drains that goes directly into the bay. Do we need an ordinance to prevent this from happening, or can you propose some other kind of an effective approach? Cindy, what are your thoughts?
I haven't heard this come up, so this is new for me too. I mean, I would say that there's obviously some challenges here in terms of public safety and public health risks, and also just the way that neighbors are feeling about having folks parked in their front on the front doorstep. So I would have to learn a lot more about this. This is the first I'm hearing about it, so I want to talk to neighbors and find out. I think this is probably an issue that impacts some neighborhoods more than other neighborhoods. And really hear what is that? There's somebody nodding and saying, yeah. So I would really want to hear from those folks and hear about what they've experienced and maybe sort of their suggestions and really take those into consideration and potentially, yeah, bring it back if there's an ordinance needed. But I really want to learn more about the issue before I can say, yes, we need to move forward on that.
Of course. Thank you, Cindy. I know I'm blindsided with a new one, but well handled.
Just going back to 32 years ago when mass homelessness broke out, one of the things that happened right after I became mayor was we got a letter from the principal of Santa Cruz High saying that they had noticed that fall that there was a surprising increased number of students who didn't give a home address. And when they looked into it, they discovered that those families were living in their cars. The economic conditions had led them to lose their homes. Many of them parked right around the high school so their kids could get to school. So to me, there is probably a poverty aspect and a housing cost aspect to this. On the other hand, we have a lot of visitors here and all the other reasons that we all know of as to why people want to come here and live cheaply. And so I too would want to really learn and understand who are the people parking their RVs or their other vehicles in the neighborhoods and what's missing there that they might need, or what can we do to protect neighborhoods from any effects. And I certainly don't like it if people are emptying their sewers into the storm drains, which does get either to the river or to the bay, and that's unacceptable.
Yes.
yeah, this has been an identified problem, and there are some streets where if you go actually pretty close to my neighborhood where the new restaurant Sake is, May Street in that area, you do see a lot of RVs on that street, and you do see some of the waste that they leave, and it's pretty unpleasant and pretty stinky. And like I said, this is literally a couple blocks from my house. It's a really hard crime to enforce. I mean, it is a crime to just, you know, take your raw sewage from your toilet and just dump it on the street. How we catch people doing this, I don't know how we do that. But if there's a way to address it, and someone has a good suggestion, it's something that I would consider putting forth. But I think it's a really hard one to enforce.
So the original question was if we need an ordinance to address this issue. And I consider an ordinance sort of a very extreme measure, which of course we're going to take after we've had a very thorough dialogue and conversation with the community. So this question is new to the Neighbors Forum, and it's new to us candidates. I haven't heard a lot about it as I've been walking, but I don't think it's a new problem in Santa Cruz. It's kind of a perennial thing that we struggle with here in town. Obviously there are health and safety codes that need to be enforced, and it's completely unacceptable to dump sewage. And I think the bigger thing is we need to engage neighbors and let them know that as city council, we're available and interested to hear their concerns. We want to listen to their concerns and work towards solutions for everybody. Some of that might involve an ordinance or enforcement, but I think a lot of it is going to involve community policing and empowering people within their own neighborhoods to take some responsibility doing that outreach and policing themselves.
Protecting our city beaches and waterways is a priority. And we heard this at the CALSB special session meeting, that this was a problem where there were illegal discharges. So council took unanimous vote and forwarded this for review by our Public Works and Transportation Commission. It's also something where other residents have looked at in terms of where you've got RVs that take over two or three spots. So I think we look at how we kind of address that. We have no station in the city of Santa Cruz where people can dump waste. I propose we give vouchers so that people can take those in other places so that we can eliminate any sort of waste in our waterways.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you all. Again, sorry to bring that to you, but I think we'll be hearing more about that. Has everybody gone first now, right? Well, it's time for you to go first again. And this is a question that of course the neighbors are very concerned about, but it's something that we see some change in over time here. Can you guys hear me very well?
Yeah.
We want to know what your perspective is on commercial development in Santa Cruz. Given these last few years, we've had a lot of change, a lot of progress in that, but there's an excruciating experience with La Bahia, and let's all hope that that's moving in a positive direction now. Are there some lessons and general guidelines that you would like to see honored for future commercial development?
Adding businesses that generate sales tax is one of the main ways that local government in California now has to increase revenue, because the property tax is no longer a significant source of revenue after Prop 13. And so I completely understand and agree with the city leadership that has felt that adding commercial developments has been a desirable thing. And that is different from hotel tax, which is another source that's under some local control. So on the other hand, to me, the idea of just getting big growth numbers or even big tax revenue numbers, if it means it's based on minimum wage jobs, then I have a problem with it, because that means that the burden of that benefit is being put on people that might need two or three jobs in order to pay the rent and feed their kids. And that's not right. And if they hit a crisis, then they're going to need more city services to deal with that. So I think that the city has a responsibility to make sure that if we do add commercial development or the economic benefit of it, whether to the private economy or to the for tax revenue, that we make sure that the whole part of it, the jobs as well as the revenues, that are good and equitable for our community.
We're actually pretty built out in Santa Cruz. We don't have a lot of land left to do development. So when we do it, I think we need to be very, very wise about what we do. And there's a development that's going to go in at 555 Pacific Avenue. It's been an ugly dirt lot, and it's kind of one of my pet peeves in town that it's been allowed to exist that way. What's going to go in there is space for commercial type businesses, whether it's retail or offices, I'm not sure. And then on the top few floors, there's going to be pretty much high density home buying opportunities, smaller units, one bedroom, studio, and two bedrooms. And I think that's the type of commercial development I'd like to see in town. Now, maybe there's some potential for the for Front Street and along there. There's a lot of kind of decrepit looking buildings that maybe we could have some more vision there. But I think kind of the mixed use building is a way to go here in Santa Cruz for the future.
So the question was about guidelines for economic development. One of the guidelines, of course, needs to be generating tax revenue. That's what we hope economic development does. One of the guidelines that we need to have is a community benefit. So we need to make sure that that tax revenue can be distributed equitably in our community. We need to make sure that that profit stays local as much as possible. So that's going to involve, I think, one of the guidelines we should have are some easing on restrictions for locally owned businesses so we can encourage locals to start more businesses here. I think one of the guidelines we also need to keep in mind is maintaining and enhancing the quality of our lives, our neighborhoods, and our natural environment as we develop. So we need to accommodate growth while we maintain the quality of our lives and our natural environment that makes all of our lives so pleasant. Thanks.
You know, investing in our community, I think, is a priority. And that doesn't mean, you know, commercial development. It's also creating affordable housing, opportunities for people to live and work here. And I think those are the mix of values that we need to focus on as a council. We see that, you know, it's a very difficult and expensive place to live. And so having the opportunity to create new jobs in Santa Cruz is something that we are focused on as a council. And I appreciate Bruce's comment of that value. One of the things that I feel that it does, though, need to do is reflect, you know, the neighborhood concerns. We worked out with PAMP, where we were able to successfully get a new development in with also addressing some of the neighborhood concerns. And I think that's key to how we kind of move forward. It's collaboratively. And I think that how we look at our fees and providing new investment in neighborhood infrastructure also reflects how we can provide for new investment in commercial development, but also respect the values of the neighbors where those new developments might take place.
So one thing that I talk a lot about is sustainable solutions. And sustainable means to me is that we're thinking about not just what we need right now, but whatever we do right now, how is that going to carry forward for us in the future? And one of the challenges we're dealing with now is the fact that we built out. And now we don't have much choice but to build up. And so what I want us to be thinking about when we're looking at guidelines is what can we do that is sustainable for our community, meaning the environment, using things that are taking into consideration our resources and how limited they are, thinking about smart use of that space that does preserve the quality of life and does allow for a broad range of people to stay within our community, meaning that we need to have small units for individuals like myself who stay here after college, and also for families who are getting started and want to have homes here. So whatever we're doing, we need to be thinking about the future and how is this going to translate into the coming decades for our community.
Thank you, Cindy. I think that's it. I think that's everybody on that one. And we have one question left. You know, if you don't mind, Dave, do you mind going first on this last one?
Sure.
It's a little bit of a blue sky kind of a thing, and I know you've thought a lot about this, but let's just kind of take a moment to think about the possibilities for the future here. Santa Cruz itself, perfect as it is, like each of its residents, can enjoy growing in ways that do not necessarily mean getting bigger. Nothing personal to anybody else. But we're talking about quality, and the primary reason why we live here is because of the quality of life that we have, and we've heard references to that tonight. Tonight we've discussed a number of related issues to that, but can you share with us your big picture priorities that might help make the future of Santa Cruz a higher quality than it is today?
Yeah. Well, you said priorities, and we have 1 minute, so I'll focus on one, and that is I've led efforts to do the first citywide parks master plan in the last 30 years. What I'm looking for is an inventory of all the opportunities we have to better invest in our parks, beaches, and open spaces. At the conclusion of that study, we'll look at all these opportunities where we can really prioritize what I believe is one of our city's primary assets, treasures, and that is maintaining our parks and beaches and open spaces for not only our community and families, but also recreational use. I'm also interested in establishing an endowment. So we set a long-term fund that invests in those parks for the long term, where we look at ways we can go above and beyond what we're currently investing. I'm also focused on our public safety initiatives. I think that the work we've done to establish the Downtown Accountability Program, I think, is one where we've seen in other communities has been successful, and I'm looking forward to continuing that deepen work with the county so that we can develop lasting solutions.
I'm really proud to be an alumni of UC Santa Cruz, and I go to a lot of alumni events, and one of the things that I really want to support is investing in young people in our community. I've met a lot of first-in-family students who have come from this county, who started at Cabrillo, transferred to UCSD, and they're committed to our community. They want to give back. And I think there needs to be a lot more opportunities to keep the young, brilliant minds that are coming out of this, both Cabrillo and UCSD, here to address a lot of the issues that we talked about tonight. There are people whose families are here. Hopefully they can be here for the next generations and they can help move forward the sustainable solutions that I've been talking about tonight. So that's something that I want to put a lot of effort into, creating that pipeline for students, especially local ones, to stay here and reinvest in our city.
I'm sure this is predictable, but to me, what will turn Santa Cruz from a gem to a jewel on the Monterey Bay is to have the centerpiece of our town, the river, be a wonderful, beautiful, safe place for everyone to enjoy. And that includes economic development, which hasn't got a lot of emphasis over the years in the river, but to me, there's tremendous underutilized potential there, right in the center of town where jobs and shopping and a lot of houses already are. We could have intensified, beautiful and appropriate scale urban development along the river, and along with the habitat restoration and the safety and the recreational value and the public art and the making the river into the centerpiece. It was the reason that Santa Cruz is located where it is, and for way too long it's been treated as either a problem or as a drain, you know, when the original industry was located here. And we need to completely turn that around, and that's what I've dedicated. I've worked on it for 4 decades, and I think I have a few decades to go, and that's why I want to be on the city council.
So this one might sound strange. I know that, you know, we've got issues of high drug use. We have issues of trying to have more jobs here. I'd like to see more people who grow up here be able to stay here, and that involves having good career technical education. But one of my biggest pet peeves, people sit in their cars, they come over 17, they sit in some really bad traffic, they get to our city gateway at Ocean and 17, and honestly, it doesn't look like a town that takes a lot of pride in the fact that we're the gateway to the National Marine Bay Sanctuary. It doesn't scream, treat our city with respect when you're here. It doesn't say pack your trash when you leave the beach, don't leave plastic. I want a gateway to the city that is Santa Cruz, that is beautiful, that's not scruffy. I want there to be trees. I want us to take the artistic talent that we have here in Santa Cruz and create this amazing gateway to our city. So when people are here, they treat it with respect and they get the message that we care about our city as well. And studies have shown that when actions like this are taken, crime goes down, graffiti goes down, and so that's one project I'd like to work on.
Well, I work with young people, so part of what's driving me to run for city council is wondering what kind of town they're going to inherit, what kind of town their kids are going to inherit. I want to be part of making sure they have a safe, sustainable, affordable place to live. So one of my priorities, I think we've done a remarkable job preserving greenbelt and open space, but we have a remarkable amount of pollution in our green space and our open spaces. I'd like to see a collaboration with UCSD students that aims at cleaning up Powell's Beach, identifying the source of that algae or bacteria that's growing there that's causing so much pollution. I'd like to see the same thing, that collaboration with UCSD students around restoring our river as well. My other big concern for the future of Santa Cruz is, of course, the neighborhoods, and that's partly because of my involvement with the block parties, but it's partly because of my involvement teaching self-defense and safety skills. So I understand that the tighter our neighborhoods are, the safer we are as a city. So one of my big concerns and priorities for the future of Santa Cruz is strengthening that cohesiveness. I also really like to work on reducing traffic.
Thank you very much. Before we move, we're going to move now to this up or down section. I'm just going to read an issue.
Here we go.
And I read this issue. You need to hold it up so everybody can see you. If anybody else
see they stand here. Up.
Yes.
They stand.
Oh, God, no thanks.
Yeah, everybody out there sees us or just.
By the way, folks, I did want to say it's not one of our questions tonight, but I think maybe some of the other council members here will go along with me on this. I know the one question that you're often asked as a council member, but you can never really come up with a good answer, is what's the matter with you? Again, you're just telling us whether you would or support or not that an initiative providing for, and the first one is license plate readers. Now, if you're not familiar with this, it's a kind of a new issue. Well, it's whether or not you'd support an initiative providing for this. Now, this is also something that there are ACLU standards out there to provide for privacy. But the issue is, in case you're not aware what those are, if there is a crime in one part of town and somebody gets the license plate or even part of it, there are only a few exit routes out of town. It takes a few minutes for that word to get around. And the license plate readers read them, notify police elsewhere, and help them as they leave town or go to other parts of town. So that's up or down. What do you think?
Did you mean a ballot measure?
I don't mean anything about it. Are you interested in? Would you even entertain a discussion? Here's your second one, and you know, some of you have tipped your hand on this. DeSalle to Santa Cruz.
What?
Support it or not at this point. No sideways. Alright, okay. So we're finding out what we want to know, are we not? How about development of the rear delay in the commercial
Can you hear you? We're not hearing the question.
You don't know what they just voted on.
Use
the mic. Because we want to know where this one is. Thank you.
What a rowdy bunch we have. The last one was the development of the River Levee into commercial and recreational zone.
Question before that. We didn't hear it.
We didn't read
the question.
And the one before that?
License plate readers.
Are both the options rubber bound? Ask the question again.
We're not telling them up or down. We're telling them reveal what you think about this, and you're to judge from that. So let's not force them into up and down. If you want to go sideways, you'll be revealing that. Okay. So we're back to development of the river legend into commercial recreation zone. Hold up the sign for us, please. Thank you. What a friendly group. Allowing the university to expand and provide more student housing. Retention of rainwater for Santa Cruz, perhaps reservoirs. More community gathering places and events like the Warriors. That's pretty easy. Water development ordinance. This is where developers pay for water conservation projects to replace the water in the projects we use. So those are all up. What a friendly bunch. How about an east side entrance to the university? And an east side entrance to the university. No.
An eastern access road.
An eastern access road to the university, yes. Okay. Well, right now we have one. How about, will you continue to support the unruly gatherings ordinance? Waiting on you, Bruce. Yeah, that is what. Oh yes, There is right now, it's really not up for discussion currently, but ADUs, the accessory dwelling units, there is some concern as to whether or not they will require that both units be owner, well, that at least one of the units be owner occupied as opposed to one be owner occupied and the other not.
Wait, what?
So an ADU is always rented. The main house can either be owner occupied or not. That's what the question is. Do both of them have to? Can both of them be rented?
No, the question was getting rid of owner occupancy. Because I asked the question.
Yes, that is the question.
Are you in favor of getting rid of owner occupancy for ADUs?
Good.
That's the question.
Well, now the ADU will be rented. At least one of the properties has to be owner occupied.
That's the current law.
That's the current law.
Are you in favor of getting rid of the current law of owner occupancy? That's the question.
Let's, do you understand that?
So are we willing to get rid of owner occupancy law?
Right.
That the owner has to live on the premises of the property.
Which is current.
Correct.
Yeah.
Are you willing to get rid of that?
Okay, thank you. Thank you. And that's the last one, because this is an unruly crowd. So thank you all very much. Thank you all very much. Good response to everyone. I do want to say just this is a great turnout and it's a good group. I like them feisty. But I do want to thank all of you for not staying at home and sitting on your couches, but to come out here and participate. We're very appreciative of that. Thank you again. Thank you again to all our candidates. Thank you, Steph. You get the cookies. Thank you.